Right, good morning.
Sweet. That's nice.
Atheists, agnostics, skeptics, free thinkers, whatever you like to call yourself, you are welcome here. At Seattle Atheist Church, we call ourselves an atheist church because you will never hear anything supernatural talked about from the podium. So in just a moment, we're going to have a talk on C. elegans. But I wanted to take this moment to remind you that tomorrow there is a secular Seattle sort of all atheist group gathering in celebration of the 4th of July. People already know about that. At the Ravenna Park from 1 till 6 p.m. tomorrow. So looking forward to seeing you guys there. And thank you for being here this morning.
All right, so let me go ahead and get started. I know this is a weird talk, but bear with me. It'll all make sense by the end, I hope. So let me start by explaining my motivation to do this talk. I'm super interested in understanding the motivations that make humans do what they do. I'm interested in emotions, mental states, all that kind of stuff. And I'm also super interested in Darwin and the descent of man. And Darwin, if you remember, in the descent of man, his main thesis was that humans are not different in kind, even if they're different in degree, from all the other living organisms on Earth. That's his central thesis of the descent of man, that you can understand humans in the same way as you could understand all the other crawly things crawling across the planet. So, therefore, if you want to understand human nature better, one approach would be to try to look at other animals, right? If we're not different in kind from other animals on the Earth, then understanding how they work can help us understand how we work. And it turns out that there's one creature on Earth that we understand more than any other creature alive. And I knew nothing about this creature as of a month ago, but then I discovered something called the Worm Atlas. And let me explain, for those of you who haven't been to the Worm Atlas, who has been to the Worm Atlas, by the way? Anyone? No one's been to the Worm Atlas. Fantastic. It's a new discovery. So Worm Atlas is what they've done is they put together this vast encyclopedia of all the information on C. elegans. And C. elegans is a little roundworm. It's about a millimeter long. We'll talk more about it in a moment. But the interesting thing about C. elegans is it's something known as a model organism. And a model organism, there's only a couple dozen of these, but these are organisms that scientists have gathered together and said that they're going to study in depth so they understand completely how it works. So C. elegans turns out to be the one organism on Earth that we understand more than anything else on the planet. And that's why I want to focus on that. And what I want to convince you is we're talking about a little millimeter roundworm here, but that you can learn a lot about humans from the way that C. elegans work. So I'll get to that later on. But let me start by talking about the Worm Atlas. Again, it's at wormatlas.org. It's an amazing site. They have Google developed these interactive videos for C. elegans. It's really cool. You can zoom in. You can see all of its internal structure. And they've collected together all the books and all the articles on C. elegans. The name C. elegans comes from, the C stands for, this is a Latin word, so there's no way I'm going to get the word right, for senior habitatus, elegans. And what it really means is it means recent, rod-like, elegant. That's what it means. This is the elegant, rod-like worm. That's what C. elegans is. And C. elegans is, as I mentioned before, the organism that we know most about. It was actually the first organism that we were able to develop the sequence the entire genome for. So it was the first creature that we had the entire genome for. It has 959 cells, exactly, not a lot of cells, 959 cells. It has about 20,000 protein-encoding genes. 20,000 genes. Now, you might think for such a little creature that, you know, humans must have many more genes, protein encoding genes, but it turns out humans only have slightly more genes in their genome than C. elegans. It's pretty close. I think humans have around 22,000 encoding genes. So pretty close in terms of the blueprints for creating life between C. elegans and humans. But the other special thing about C. elegans is it is still the only organism where we have the entire connectome for. And the connectome, I don't know if you've been reading, Barack Obama has been pushing that for humans, but the idea behind the connectome is it's a complete list of all the neurons in C. elegans. It has exactly 302 neurons, and that's a third of all the cells in C. elegans are neurons. takes up a lot of space. For comparison, humans have 86 billion neurons. So, you know, not as, you know, C. elegans has 302. Humans have 86 billion, so that is a difference in degree, quite a bit there. But before you get too arrogant, remember that elephants have 267 billion. So humans only have 86 billion, elephants have 267 billion. So a lot more neurons than elephants. But the special thing about C. elegans is we not only, so we actually have a whole database of every neuron, and each neuron has a letter code, a two or three letter code for each of the neurons. But the special thing about C. elegans is we also know how all the neurons connect together. We know all the synapses between the neurons. There are about 7,500 total synapses between all the neurons. So we have the full circuit wiring of a C. elegans brain. And we don't have that for any other organism on Earth, but we fully understand all the cells, all the neurons in C. elegans. Okay, and we also have at this point a very good understanding of what most of those neurons do. And the way that they figure, I thought this was kind of cool, the way they figure out what the neurons in C. elegans do, they have a number of techniques, but one technique is they fire little lasers and they burn up the neurons and then they see how it changes the behavior of C. elegans. So they're able to correlate pretty closely particular neurons with particular behavior. Now I'll talk about what some of the different groups of neurons do in a moment, but we have a pretty good understanding of even at the level of neurons what's going on with C. elegans. All right. So let me talk about some odd facts about C. elegans before we move on so we can get to know this little worm a little better before we get to the main stuff. You can find C. elegans in your compost pile in the back of your house. So if you look at rotting fruit, you'll find the little C. elegans crawling around in them. They are, as I mentioned before, about a millimeter long. They live for about 2 weeks. They have a very short and sweet lifespan, 2 weeks. But they can reproduce in as low as 3 days. So they're great for experiments, right? Because you can reproduce them really, really quickly. They are almost all hermaphrodites. But here's the weird thing. 1 in 1,000 gets to be a male. So 1 in 1,000, so most of them are hermaphrodites, but every once in a while you get a male C. elegans. Oh, and this is the coolest thing. So when C. elegans die, they have something called the death fluorescence. And the death fluorescence is a dramatic burst of blue fluorescence when they die. It's their little soul going up to heaven. Whenever C. elegans, just kidding. Whenever C. elegans die, they have a chemical in their stomach that when C. elegans die, you can actually see a flash in the microscope of blue fluorescence as they leave the world, which is kind of cool. Imagine if that happened with humans, right? If when humans, then people would definitely believe in the soul if there was a blue flash whenever a human died. And another fact about C. elegans, like the monster in Alien, C. elegans go through different stages of development. They molt and go through the different stages. Normally they go through 4 stages of development, but when food resources are low, they go through a special phase. Oh, I'm gonna try to pronounce this word, a dour phase, where what happens is they go into the special phase where they don't have a mouth, and they're really thin, and they can last for months without any food at all. So they go into a special low resource stage if there's not enough resources around. It's kind of cool. And finally, C. elegans do sleep. I find that odd to think of the little worm taking a nap, but they do go into a restful state, and they sleep very much like other animals do. All right. So from the description so far, you might be thinking, well, these little millimeter creatures can't be that complex. I mean, how complicated can the behavior of a C. elegans be? Remember, they only have 302 neurons. That's like nothing, right? You think on a computer, you could simulate that super easy. 7,500 synapses, that's, you know, but there's no complexity there. But it turns out that they have very elaborate behavior. Now I want to talk about that behavior right now. The basic behavior of a C. elegans is they spend most of their time swimming through soil. They spend most of their time just sort of swimming forward, wiggling back and forth, moving through the soil. Occasionally, they make spontaneous reversals. They do a little omega move, you know, like the Greek omega letter. So they like turn around and then they go the opposite direction. It's kind of cool, but that's how they spend most of their time. About 32 of their neurons, that's about 10%. Remember, they only have 302 neurons, are used to detect different chemical smells. So they're attracted to different chemicals, they're repelled from other chemicals, and they spend a lot of time doing that. They can also detect different temperature gradients, and they go through that. And they have about 5 things called command interneurons, and that's connected up to those chemical detectors, and it just makes their body move in different directions. So that's how they move around, a typical, you know, C. elegans day. Now, C. elegans, they eat E. coli mainly. That's what they eat. They go around and munch on some E. coli. And they have three standard behaviors. They have something called a dwelling behavior. If they find a big carpet of E. coli, what they'll do is they'll just go around in little circles and keep eating up all the E. coli. When resources become low, they go into a different mode called a scanning mode, where they'll start to increase their speed. And so they'll start, you know, moving further and further away from the original source of the food. And then finally, they can't find food anymore, they'll disperse out. So they'll stop turning at all, and they'll all move off into different directions. So those are the three basic, you know, motions that they do. Now, one of the things that they discovered was that if you tap one of these roundworms, one of the C. elegans, not at the very top, but a little below the top of its head, what it'll do is it'll exhibit this really strange behavior. So normally they're moving along, swimming along, wiggling their head back and forth, and they're moving forward looking for food. But if you tap them on the very front, what they'll do is they'll stop moving their head and they'll reverse motors. They'll reverse motors and start backing up. I like to think of them like submarines. But they'll start backing up, and they couldn't figure out why they were doing it for a long time. But they finally figured out why they were doing it. I think this is one of the coolest features of C. elegans. It turns out that C. elegans, they have predators. They have predators that live. There's a special type of fungi that what they do is they have these little hoops they extend where they try to capture C. elegans in the hoop. C. elegans moving around, they put their little hoops out, and then they capture and they constrict them, and then they gobble them up. So it's a little bit, it's like little C. elegans tigers roaming around in the C. elegans, you know, in the jungle, where they're hunting down the C. elegans and gobbling them up. So they think the C. elegans actually evolved so that when you tap them in the head, they're smart enough to stop wiggling their head, right? Because they have to back out of the hoop so that they can escape. So that's clearly a behavior that they adapted for the environment to be able to handle predators. But it turns out that there's more to the behavior of C. elegans. I should mention, though, this behavior of escaping capture in that way is one of the rare examples where we have the complete path from sensory neuron to coordinated motor output, and where we understand that complete path at the level of neuron firing. So we actually understand everything that's involved from, you know, the sensation of being tapped, what neurons are fired off, how those neurons are interconnected with the motor neurons that cause it to change its behavior and back out. We understand that at a mechanistic level. And that's one of the very rare examples of any animal at all where we can describe a complete behavior down to the level of the neuron, which is pretty cool. All right, but there's more. So C. elegans, it turns out, they learn. They actually exhibit all sorts of learning behavior, which again, I found shocking because I thought they were dumb little worms in the compost pile, but they actually do learn. One of the things that that you can do of C. elegans is if you have a bunch of C. elegans in a petri dish and you tap on the petri dish, they'll actually reverse direction. So they'll respond to it, they'll respond to the vibration, and over time they'll adapt to that, so they'll do less reversals. So that's a type of learning. The other type of learning they have is, so C. elegans love the smell of artificial popcorn butter. It's something that they'll just, you know, run toward. They love artificial popcorn butter. And so what they found, though, is if you mix artificial popcorn butter and you mix it with an acetic acid solution, they'll actually learn not to go for the artificial popcorn butter anymore. They'll build associations. They're able to, remember, we're only working with 302 neurons here, but they're able to build up associations and learn not to go after certain, you know, chemical smells that they went after before, which I find pretty amazing. In their article, there's an article called An Elegant Mind. Get the title, it's funny, C. elegans. Anyway, An Elegant Mind, the authors write, the deterministic development of the worm's nervous system would seem to limit its usefulness as a model to study behavioral plasticity. But time and again, the worm has demonstrated its extreme sensitivity to experience. Every sensory modality studied can mediate learning. Work with C. elegans confirms the importance of learning and memory to survival. even this relatively small organism shows a large number of degrees of freedom in adapting its behavior to reflect its experience. In other words, it's surprisingly smart, right? This little teeny worm. Okay, so why this fascination with C. elegans? I mean, it's kind of cool. It's a little worm, it can learn things. Why am I fascinated with it? Well, because I want to understand, and people can understand, you can understand C. elegans down to the mechanistic level, right? You could build a robot, theoretically, that behaves in exactly the same way as C. elegans. There's no mysteries there. You don't need any soul stuff to be able to explain the behavior of C. elegans. It's, you know, you just understand the neurons, you understand the chemistry, and you can predict its behavior in a very clear way. So there's no mystery to how it behaves, and yet it shows a surprising complexity of behavior. So that raises the question, you know, how close is C. elegans to our mental experience of the world? When a C. elegans, when it smells that artificial popcorn, does it feel hungry? Does it say, oh, gotta have some popcorn? Does it have the feeling of hunger? When it gets caught in the hoop, when it's about to be eaten by one of those fungi, does it feel fear? Does it say, oh no, I gotta escape, and it has to, you know, back out of that hoop? Another way of saying that is C. elegans more like a thermostat, where we assume that there's no emotional feelings at all, no consciousness, no nothing? Or is it more like a human, where we assume that there's feelings and conscious experiences of the world? And, you know, if it's not like a thermostat, then, you know, what's the extra stuff? Well, I mean, we understand this thing pretty well, so what's the magical extra stuff in C. elegans that would make it feel fear or make it, you know, feel hunger? This led me to start reading the work of a neuroscientist called Joseph Ledoux. And Joseph Ledoux, he's published a number of papers just in the last couple of years. He's a neuroscientist who works at New York University, and he talks about C. elegans, and he talks about his main interest is emotions and trying to understand it in terms of other organisms. In his article, Rethinking the Emotional Brain, what he argues is, instead of trying to move from human emotions and human mental states and trying to decide whether other organisms have those mental states, we should be working from the bottom up instead of the top down. What he argues is we should start by thinking about the behaviors of C. elegans and think of them in terms of survival circuits. And by survival circuits, he means something very, very broad. He means a survival circuit is anything involved in defense, maintenance of energy, nutritional supplies, fluid balance, thermoregulation, and reproduction. Anything that C. elegans needs to survive is considered a survival circuit. So, you know, eating behavior, escaping behavior, all of that is a survival circuit. And what he wants to argue is it's a mistake to take an emotion like fear and try to apply it to C. elegans, because C. elegans survival circuits are more fundamental than that. They would decompose into a bunch of different survival circuits, and he wants to argue actually the same thing is true for humans, but he wants to work from the bottom up to the top instead of trying to apply our folk psychology concepts to C. elegans. So he also wants to argue, of course, that these circuits, survival circuits, are highly conserved across species, but expressed in different species-specific behavioral responses. For example, when escaping from a threat, a human might flee on two legs, a bat might fly away, and a whale might swim away. So they might express these survival circuits in different ways, in species-specific ways, but the underlying survival circuit is the same. They're afraid, right? And they're expressing it in different ways. He writes, but the thrust of what has been said here is that survival functions should not be treated as qualitatively different in humans and other mammals. In mammals and other vertebrates, invertebrates and invertebrates. A case can even be made that solutions to fundamental problems of survival are in the final analysis derived from solutions to these problems present in primordial single-cell organisms. So he wants to say that the basic structure, this is echoing Darwin, right? The basic behaviors of animals is conserved all the way up from single-cell bacteria all the way to, you know, C. elegans, to whales, and to humans. That these survival circuits are expressed in different ways and conserved across different species. I actually didn't know this either. Even single cell organisms show signs of associative behavior. You can teach, they can learn. I have no idea how bacteria pull that off, but that's what he's referring to here in terms of single cell organisms. Now what he wants to say, so he just, he has another article where he focuses mainly on the emotion of fear, trying to understand fear. And what he wants to claim in that article is that there are two different notions of fear. That we have an ordinary language notion of fear, and that's what, when we talk about being afraid of a spider or afraid of someone holding a gun to your head, that we mean by our ordinary language notion of fear, we mean the feeling of fear, the heart rate, you know, going up, our experience of fear, our conscious experience of fear. And he wants to differentiate that from the survival circuit that he's talking about. So he wants to say, claim that the question of whether C. elegans experiences fear in the same way as humans is not phrased well. It's conflating two different notions of fear. Because what he wants to say is, there is no question that C. elegans has a certain survival circuit that we would equate with fear. It runs away, it escapes from its predator, it shows the fearful behavior, but that's a very different question than whether or not C. elegans feels fear, is conscious of fear. And he wants to claim that those are different brain mechanisms. The mechanism of consciousness, while it might have a survival function, is different from the mechanism that allows us to escape predators. Okay. So this is really the same as the William James point, which we talked about a few sermons ago, that you don't run away from a bear because you feel afraid. The William James point is you run away from the bear and then you feel afraid afterwards. That it's not, that your feelings are not causal in your behavior. That they're, at least in your present behavior, what your feelings do is they might contribute to your future behavior, but they have nothing to do with what you're doing in the moment. So he's making that same point, and he backs this up in a number of different ways. One way he does it is by citing research into different behaviors having to do with appetites, like eating, drinking, and drugs, that show that this research is supposed to show that people don't take drugs because it feels good. People take drugs, the things that cause them to motivate and reinforce taking drugs has nothing to do with their conscious feeling of the drugs. The other way they supports this is by using, studies of people with blind sight. Are you guys familiar with blind sight? Blind sight is very cool if you've ever come across. So there are people who have their visual cortex damaged. So they don't actually have any conscious experience of seeing at all. But they still have a bunch of the connections into the brain, just not into the visual cortex. So they can still learn things from what they see, they just don't know it. They're completely unconscious of it. So they can't see, but they can see. That's why it's called blind sight, because consciously they're unable to see things. And they've done experiments with blind sight to show that people behave in a fearful-like manner, even though they're completely unaware of it. They're not conscious of being afraid at all, but they act in a manner that's afraid. Some of the other research there, he appeals to a psychologist named T.D. Wilson, who wrote a really great book, Strangers to Ourselves, great book, interesting, where he makes many of the same points that Ledoux does about the difference between your unconscious state and your conscious state and how they have very different functions in your brain. So one of his, this is an anecdote, so don't take it too seriously, but just to clarify what they're trying to get at here, he talks about, so there's these patients, right, who have no long-term memory. They can't remember anything at all. You come in the room, introduce yourself, you leave the room, you come back again, and it's like, oh, hi, who are you? I've never met you before. You reintroduce themselves, and they can't form long-term memories. So they've been used for a number of different psychological experiments. But one of the experiments in 1913, this is an old one, a doctor did an experiment where what he did is he came into the room with a person with no long-term memory, and he hit a little pin in his palm. And he came up and shook the patient's hand. He pricked the patient's hand and ouch, you know, patient didn't like that. Then he left the room and then he came back and then he offered his hand again and the patient refused to take his hand. He didn't remember who he was and he couldn't actually say why he didn't want to shake the doctor's hand. All he could say was, oh, I don't feel like shaking people's hands today. No, let's not shake hands. You know, all sorts of different reasons to explain why no handshaking was going on. And that's supposed to be more evidence that there can be a disassociation between your conscious experience of something and your actual, you know, behavior in the situation. One more example of that. So another thing that's important in psychology is this idea of theory of mind. So you have this, so children develop something called a theory of mind where they start representing other people as having beliefs about the world. And that's an actual stage in development. And so they experiment with theory of mind. They have this is a cool experiment. What they do is they sit a child down, and they have the child watch one child walk in. Let's call the child Matt. Matt will walk in with a piece of candy. Matt will hide the piece of candy in a box. And then Matt will leave. And then another kid will walk in, Sally, and move that piece of candy over to a basket, right? And then the question is, when Matt walks back in again, where does the kid think that Matt should look for the candy? And it turns out that if you're young enough, the kid will just say, well, Matt will look for the piece of candy in the basket, right? Because that's where the piece of candy is. So they're not actually representing, they don't have a concept, they don't have a way to represent the mental states of Matt or Sally. They're just using their own mental states to make decisions about other people. But it turns out when kids get to the age of 4, then they'll start saying, well, you know, when Matt comes in, he still thinks it's over there in the box, because that's where Matt put it, he put it in the box. And so, you know, though they can understand, they can represent other people's beliefs. All right, so that's a pretty standard experiment. But what they did is they did a variation of this experiment, where what they did is, instead of just relying on the child's verbal representation of the situation, they watched for where the kid would look when Matt came back into the room. And it turns out that even older kids, that kids up to the age of 4, will look in the right place. So they'll look using the mental representation of what Matt should believe, even if they can't verbalize it. And so one of the objections that like T.D. Wilson has is all of this reliance on people's self-reports of their mental states are probably just wrong. And there's a lot of those in psychology, right? Actually, a lot of the emotion research has to do with people taking surveys, detailing their, you know, how they're feeling at the moment. And there's a lot of research that T.D. Wilson is pointing out that just shows that people have no idea what's going on in their mind. You can't rely on people's self-report, because that's a completely different constructed, you know, theory of what's going on in their head. And actually, in real life, there's different things going on in the background. So that's what he's getting to. So this is actually a quote from T.D. Wilson. The best explanation of this and subsequent studies is that the looking and verbal measures reflect different kinds of knowledge that develop at different rates. The looking measure may have tapped a non-conscious, implicit type of knowledge, in my terms, knowledge acquired by the adaptive unconscious, whereas the verbal measure tapped a conscious understanding of the theory of mind that takes longer to develop. All right, so I'm coming to the end of this talk. So let me explain first why I'm interested in C. elegans and what I think this has to do with understanding human mental states. Main reason I'm interested in C. elegans is this is the only organism that we completely understand. It's special. It's this model organism where we understand what all the neurons do, what all the cells do. We have a completely mechanistic understanding of C. elegans. We don't have to use any spooky stuff to be able to predict what it's going to do. We can just use standard science and make predictions about it. And it's complex. It shows complex behavior. Now, my confusion with C. elegans, though, is, well, what about all the, you know, feelings of emotion and mental states and consciousness? All the stuff that people like Descartes would say, that's us, right? The feelings or interaction with the environment or actual, you know, where's all that stuff in C. elegans? And the answer that Ledoux suggests is that it's just not there. It's not there because there's a different way that to have those types of conscious experiences, you have to have a different mental faculty that is capable of inspecting your own mental states and being able to use introspection to see. You need the flashlight in your mind to be able to look around. And again, the idea is that's not something spooky. That's just a different mental mechanism. It's a different survival circuit, but it's not. It's something that can be separated conceptually from what's going on with emotions and from mental states. So that's it. Let's stop here and discuss.